Amen. Thank you for being at church this morning. Good to see everybody here. Welcome to Bethel Baptist. If you would, take your hymn book and let's turn to hymn 542. Hymn 542, let's all stand and let's sing When We All Get to Heaven. I tell you what, this whole world is rough enough to deal with. At least we get to look forward to, because of salvation and the forgiveness of sins, we get to look forward to a much better place with a much better eternity than what we face here on earth. And so let's sing about when we all get to heaven, like we can't wait till the day we get to get there. All right, here we go. Hymn 542, on the first.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace in the
trusting, serving every day. That's how we're going to make it through here on earth. Let's go ahead and sing it. Here we go on the third.
Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will absorb every day. When we all
to see you this morning, and look forward. Boy, we've had a beautiful week of weather. I think it changes here soon, but we've had a very beautiful week of weather. Thoroughly enjoyed it, and God's given us another beautiful day to enjoy. And I thank you for being in God's house to start it off. No better way to start a week than right here in the Lord's presence. We might get a challenge, and honestly, might get a resurgence of life as a Christian that we might go out and face this world for the next week. And so let's take advantage of every single bit of it. And again, look forward to what we have ahead of us this morning. Brother Hardwalker, if you don't mind, would you ask a blessing on this morning's service? Amen. You may be seated. Let me just give you a few announcements here and see if I can read these off appropriately. Okay, so Saturday, March 30th, that's around right around the corner. That's this coming Saturday, right? Yes. And if y'all are like most of us, can y'all believe we're almost done with March? 3 months of 2019, almost in the history books. That's just crazy. But no wonder I can't keep straight what day it is. But this coming Saturday, March 30th, From 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock is going to be the wedding shower for Miss Janelle Baker. And so, ladies, it is put on here. There is a sign-up sheet in the front there. And please sign up to bring some food. And then also just to let you know, she is registered. If you ladies know how all that stuff works, but she is registered at Walmart and Bed Bath and Bed Bath and Beyond. So those two areas, you can look her up and see what all she's registered for. So then Sunday night, the 31st, which is next Sunday night, be the last service of the month of March. We will be observing the Lord's Supper, and so starting now, go ahead and let's be searching our heart, preparing, because it's not just a thing we do. It's not something we do to appease our God. It's something we do in honor and respect of what He's done for us. And it's a reminder time frame, a time to be sober, and therefore we also need to be serious concerning that matter. And looking forward to it. It's always a sweet service, and so let's be here next Sunday evening, especially for observing the Lord's Supper. And then the ladies will have their picnic on the porch, and that will be April 13th at Miss Rhoda's house. And so there'll be more details on that as we get closer to it. I believe that's all. Can you believe I'm done with the announcements? I'm going to stop right there, not go any further. Amen, Brother Bill. But where the choir at this time is going to sing a song. This has been the song that we have had more trouble trying to sing. But it is a beautiful song in the precious name of Jesus. And we're going to get the opportunity this morning to sing it one more time. And Lord willing, to be a blessing to you. But understand, we often downplay it a little bit. We forget just how important the name of Jesus is. And I know because the charismatics and all the different groups that go wild with it have kind of hijacked the whole idea of the name of Jesus. But the Bible tells us the power that we need, the power to do what no human being can accomplish. It is through the name of Jesus. It is at the name of Jesus that Satan and all of his ilks, it's in the name of Jesus, they tremble. They don't like that. And so it is a very important name. And unless we take it for granted, we're going to sing about it this morning. And consider the words that are being said in this song, in the precious name of Jesus. Take your hymn book and let's turn to hymn 532. Oh, happy day. Hymn 532. Is it not the same old happy day you might be thinking of? Okay. So, let's all stand. Hymn 532. Let's sing together. Oh, happy day. On the first.
Oh, happy day that makes my joy.
Wonderful day that was. Now, I know, looking around, it looks like pretty much everybody here I know, but hey, never take for granted that everybody in the house of God knows the God of this house. And so let me tell you, if you don't know how that happy day should feel because you just don't understand what it feels like to know Christ as your personal Savior, that is one thing that can be remedied at any given moment upon the point that somebody says, you know what, I think I'll just trust God and ask Him to forgive me as He said He would if I would come to Him. And so today is that day. If you don't know Christ as your personal Savior, say, well, I don't know about that happy day. Well, we can help you find that happy day today if you need to trust Christ as your Savior. Be more than happy to talk with you about that. But otherwise, child of God, rejoice. Be excited. This is not a funeral, all right? And we're in the house of God because we get to spend time with the Lord. And with that, we get to spend time with God's people. I understand there are some families that, in times past, family reunions for some people is not all that much fun. And then there are some that have way too much fun with their reunions. But one thing is for sure, with the house of God and the family of God, every time we get to come together ought to be a joyous time. Because this is a family that we have an anchor, we have a center point that's better than any other, and that is Christ Jesus. And with that, let me read this. I know the usher's going to get tired of standing, so are you. But just think, I got to do it all morning. But you would think I'd preach shorter with that. But oh well. Here's just a little bit of a lighthearted thought, all right? I see y'all smiling. I see it. Eric Holstrom, a preacher, he wrote in a leadership magazine. Here's what he said. This is not anything major, just lighthearted. He said, while I was preaching one Sunday, an elderly woman, her name was Mary, she fainted and struck her head on the end of a pew. That's the one thing you never want to see happen in church. But immediately, an EMT in the congregation called an ambulance and went over there to her. As they strapped her to the stretcher and got ready to head out the door, Mary regained consciousness. She motioned for her daughter to come near, and everyone, just teary-eyed, thought that she was summoning her strength to convey what could be her final words to her daughter. The daughter leaned over until her ear was right up against her mother's mouth, and she heard her whisper, my offering is in my purse. And then they rolled her out. And so, see, told you, just lighthearted. But it was clear. Her desire was, that belongs to God. Make sure it gets in there. I'm going to the hospital. Make sure that God's money gets in the plate. But I thought that would be a little bit of fun just to have something to laugh about this morning. All right. But let's continue to be faithful in our giving. And I'll say it this one last Sunday. If you haven't filled out one of the promise cards, but you still haven't, you've been praying about what the Lord would have you do for the cause of missions, and you have yet to put that in, I encourage you, fill it out and tear it in half as it's perforated, and then put the one half into the offering plate. If you still haven't done that, and we'll try to get again, we're watching to see the consistency of what comes in. And we'll begin to look at in the next couple of months, who we might be able to take on as increasing our missionary outreach and who we help to get around the world. And so just continue to be faithful in all those areas, and the Lord will bless what we give way beyond what we could possibly do with it ourselves. So let's just continue to be obedient and faithful in that area. Brother Steve Sherrill, if you would pray for that. Amen. we've got a lot of talent here at the church, and appreciate all the ladies that play the piano, and appreciate Miss Wanda and her faithfulness to play. Always enjoy getting to hear her sing. So she's going to sing for us this morning, just before the preaching. Very appropriate for this morning. If you would, take your Bibles and let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. Sorry, you can take that down. That's from last week. I forgot to give them what I was preaching. Ignore the screen or you will be confused. All right. 1 Peter chapter 4. And we're going to go to verse number 1 through verse number 7. And this morning, I'm going to preach on the thought, what's your mindset? All right? What is your mindset? We are looking here and going to be dealing with mostly doing the will of God. All right, just following the will of God. The Bible, as we read through, if you go through your Bible, you'll find that the phrase doing the will of God, or the phrase the will of God, is mentioned over 32 times in your Bible. And so when the Lord says it once, it's worth listening to. When he says it twice, you better perk up. When he continues to say something over and over again, we better not fail to listen. Because if we fail to listen, we're going to be the ones in the end in the wrong, and we're going to be in trouble. And so we need to be very careful to pay attention to this matter of the will of God. And we've mentioned before, you know, well, preacher, how do I know God's will for my life? I don't understand. I've never experienced that, you know, that peace of just knowing for sure what God wanted me to do. We've mentioned it before just recently, and I will always say it this way because it's the experience that we have had. It's biblical. You find it in God's word. But when you follow the known will of God for your life, he reveals the unknown as it's time. When we follow what we already know to do, God finds faithfulness and he says, let me show you a new step, a next step, and I will reveal to you in each step through obedience what you are to do next. And again, we talked a little bit about that dealing on Sunday nights with the pictures of faith and the different people that walked and did by faith what God showed them. But he didn't always show them everything up front. He showed them pieces, and typically he did not come to those who were being, well, I'll put it this way, he never came to those who were being disobedient and said, let me show you how great I'm going to use you. He always came to those who were found faithful and said, let me take you to a new step, a new level of service in my will. And so let's look at this real quick at what our mindset is, because it really comes down to the way we think. It's the truth is in God's word, but let me say this, and again, I'm shooting a rabbit before I even get started. But the truth of God is here. Truth has always been surrounding us. The world, now I know there are places where the gospel has not gotten to, and I know there are places where they don't have an entire Bible yet, but there are many places where this book is already saturated the population, and yet people, especially in America, though truth is always around, they're not of the mindset to search it out. They're not of the mindset to want it. They're not of the mindset to desire to follow it. And so it's not a lack of truth that hurts us the most. It's the way we think that gets in our way. And so what is our mindset this morning? Let's look at verse number 1 through verse number 7 of 1 Peter chapter 4. It says, for as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. Now that whole, that idea of arming yourself, it's talking about, listen, we're in a battle. Arm yourself with the mindset of Christ. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. Now some people will take that and say, see, when we arm ourselves with the mind of Christ, when we're like Christ, we can be sinless. No, that's not what it's saying. Okay? What it's saying is, when your mind is stayed on the Lord, when your mind is on truth, when temptation comes your way, but your mind and your intentions and your heart is stayed on Him, you have that much more ability to resist the temptation. Therefore, we don't fall into sin by accident. We walk into sin by choice. So when our mind is armed with the mind of Christ, when the temptation hits us, we have the ability to say, no, thank you. I'm going this direction. The mind of Christ, what would Christ do? He would not give in to that. He would stay in the direction of God's will for my life. And so therefore, when we are armed with the mind of Christ, he that has suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin. It is a real struggle, but we can win the victory over sin on a daily basis if we have the mind of Christ. That's what it's teaching us. Then, verse number 2, that he no longer should live, now watch, live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. When we have the right mindset, we can have a heart and a desire and a thought process that focuses on God's will, not the will of the flesh. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles, the will of the flesh, when we walked in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatries, wherein they think it strange that ye run not with them in the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you. By the way, when you try to live right, when you live in the sight of God, as he would look down, he's looking for the righteous, he's looking for those as his servants of the past. He found righteous men that he could use in the center of his will. When God still looks today and he looks for the righteous, he looks for those who are trying to live right, those who have the right mindset, those who have the right goals and perspectives based off of God's will. When he looks and finds those individuals, he directs them into his specific will in bigger areas, in other areas of our life. But we understand here that the time past we served the flesh, but we're not supposed to walk in lasciviousness and lust. And as we walk according to how Christ would have us to walk, as we walk in the will of God and our mind is stayed on God's purpose for my life, this world is going to actually begin to think us strange. Why don't they run with us anymore? Why don't they think like us anymore? Why they got to be so fuddy-duddy and go to church every single time the doors are open? Why do they got to talk about reading the Bible so much? It's just a book like any other. Why do they got to this? Why do they got to that? Why don't they this? Why don't they that? The world will start doing that because they think it's strange that ye run not with them, as verse number 4 said, to the same excess of riding. Speaking, now watch, not only thinking strange of you, but they will speak evil. Get on Facebook and take a stand in the right way, not the wrong way, but in the right way. And I say Facebook, it's the common gossip session area nowadays. But it used to be get on the phone, call somebody, okay? But you get anywhere around any crowd and take a stand for what's right. You see something inappropriately put on Facebook, or you hear something inappropriately said in a group, speak up and say, I don't appreciate that. That's not appropriate. And see if people don't make fun of you. See if people don't jump at the opportunity to slam anybody. Listen, we're supposed to be acceptive to all people. We're supposed to make sure that we're inclusive to everybody's thoughts, except for when it's our thoughts, and then we're not included. When it's righteousness thoughts, when it's God's thoughts, when it's biblical things, we're to keep our mouth shut. You ever notice that flip side of that coin? You're supposed to be acceptive to everybody else's thoughts and all their opinions and everything they have to say. Even if it's against what you believe, you should just accept it. That's their way of thinking. It's appropriate. They should have their say. It's a free country. Yeah, then you try to say something about God's word and how something is wrong and how people ought to stop falling in line with all the sin and everything else going on and see how quick you get shut up. And even sometimes, even so-called Christians jump on the bandwagon because many times those who claim the name of Christ, or I'm not saying they're not saved, but they may not be what they ought to be as a child of God. And they jump on the bandwagon of the world because they're not strange to the world. They agree with the world. Let anybody say something against what they're doing, and it doesn't matter if it's Bible or not, they ought to keep their mouth shut because it's my personal business, not theirs. Now you know I'm speaking the truth because you see it all the time, you hear it all the time. The world not only will not like us and think us strange, but they will speak evil of you if you follow the will of God. Preacher, you're not building a very good case for enjoying this following the will of God thing. Nobody said it was going to be always enjoyable. We're talking about what's right. You never go wrong following God's will, but it may not be the easiest road. Verse number 5 says, who shall give account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead? For this cause was the gospel preached also to them that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the spirit. Listen, men are going to judge you and I. But it's important that we live according to God and not according to men. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. The whole point goes back to verse number 2, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh, the lust of men, but to the will of God. What's our mindset this morning? I'm going to give you a few points here, a few things to think about concerning this mindset of doing the will of God, and then we'll be done. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this morning. Thank you for your house. Thank you for your people being faithful to be in the house of God this morning. Again, a beautiful day you've given us. How good you are to us in spite of who we are, Lord, in spite of our failures. We thank you for your love. We thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us. Thank you for Christ dying on the cross of Calvary. I pray that you'd help us this morning as we look at the will of God, as we look at what you have designed for us, Heavenly Father, that we might desire it over anything else. We ask it all in Christ's name. Amen. Let me just encourage you this morning, and again, this is not as much a salvation message, but I will say this. There is an initial will of God for every single human being, and that is the will of God that every single person that's ever born to understand what it is to be forgiven of the sin nature that they are born in, and therefore have that sin washed away, never to be remembered again, never to be brought up again in accusation that would stick whatsoever. For the advocate would stand before the Father and say, that guilt is no longer on their account. It's been taken care of. It's been covered because they've asked for forgiveness by the blood of Jesus Christ, sin is washed away. And the will of God for every single human being, the Bible tells us that the Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That whole idea of the will of God. He is not willing. Therefore, if He's not willing that they perish, what is the will of God? But that all should come to repentance. So God desires that all. By the way, that right there slams Calvinism. If there's anybody here that has ever looked into or been encouraged to lean towards the Calvinistic idea that God has chosen some for salvation and chosen some to be judged from birth, they have no choice. What God has preordained is going to happen, and therefore you don't get a chance to receive Christ. If you've already been chosen to be one cast into hell, then you cannot be saved. Well, what happened to God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. By the way, all means all, and that's all that all means. There's nothing else it can mean. And so therefore, when He says that all, His desire, His will is that all should come to repentance, God doesn't desire for one single person of His creation, not one single precious creation for that He allows to be born, that He allows to live, that comes to a knowledge and understanding of what sin is, reaches what we believe is that point of accountability in their life when they know what sin is, they know what they've done. Listen, that doesn't take very long, okay? Let me just be honest with you. It's very obvious that a baby is a sinner. Y'all, come on, think back, all right? And I've done this before with other places, but babies are wicked little things. They really are. They're selfish. Oh, they're so cute. No, they're selfish, okay? There are times when they are in need and they're hungry, and that's genuine. There are times when they are dirty, and that is genuine. And when that happens, I'm nowhere near. Just forget it. I'm out of here, okay? But there are times when they've been fed, they've been changed, they've been held, and yet they're screaming bloody, ah! And you go pick them up. As soon as you pick them up, whoop! Ah! Ah! That's what happens. As soon as they feel the bed, oh, they start screaming again. You go to set them down, they start screaming. They're liars. They're screaming bloody murder, like, I'm dying! They're not dying, they just want their way. Okay, now listen, they may not fully comprehend the whole idea of what sin is and how Christ died on the cross, but there will come a day, and it's at different ages for every single person, that there comes a day when an individual understands they are a sinner, and they know what sin is, and they understand that there was a Savior who died on the cross, and then they come to the point they understand that I need a Savior to forgive me of my sin so I can go to heaven. And without Christ, there is no hope of forgiveness. When a person comes to that understanding because of the truth of God, when they are of an age where all of a sudden it clicks, they know they're accountable for what they know. At that moment, they have a choice to make. And if they wait until it's too late, the choice will have passed by them without them deciding the right thing. And they will have made a choice to not accept the free gift. Sometimes it's at a young age. Sometimes people, they come to that realization at a young age and they still resist until they're in their adulthood life. And some folks have gone way on into the, right before they go into eternity and they get right with God and receive Him as their Savior. And some folks have had it on their deathbed, had the opportunity to receive Christ just before passing. But here's the sad fact. Those that wait until the very end, they had nothing in life, no time to live for God. They are saved as so by fire. They are saved from eternity separated from God, but they have nothing in their life to be able to cast back at His feet because they followed the will of God. They followed their will all the way to the end. Listen, that's not the best solution. That's not the best plan. People say, well, I just want to sow my wild oats. Yeah, but sometimes there's a problem. Those wild oats will eventually produce a crop. And there are times when people have finally given their life to the Lord and they finally tried to follow the will of God. And every step, they have these things from the past that keep getting in their way. And Satan keeps using the wild oats finally produce a fruit. And they wish that that fruit wouldn't even exist. Because now they really want to serve God and they can't seem to get a foot forward for taking two or three steps backwards because of all the things they're facing that they sowed when they lived for the devil. Now listen, doing the will of God is very important. It is the will of God that every individual receive Christ as their Savior. And yes, God does intend that everyone have the choice of their own to decide whether or not to choose Christ or to choose their own selves. Calvinism out the door. But in the end, when we choose Christ and we have now a heavenly Father, we're part of the family of God because of the forgiveness of sins. It is now time to consider the will of God beyond just salvation. God does not just show up every now and then with, oh, hey, by the way, I've got a little something for you to do. God's will for our life is a 24/7 process. God has a will all the time, a direction, a plan all the time for our life. And every now and then, he'll show up with some very specific things he has designed for our life. And he says, it's time now to invest this in you. It's time now to give you this opportunity. But that's not saying he didn't already have you walking in his will before then. He desires that we follow him each and every step. Understand, the will of God and the mindset we ought to have is a heart issue to begin with. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 5 and 6 says, servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart as unto Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. It says singleness of heart, doing the will of God from the heart. It is a heart issue. If people struggle to follow God consistently in their life, and this is not a finger point message, this is just as much towards me as a preacher as it is towards any other individual. There's not a single child of God that doesn't fight the flesh. Every single one of us, if we're not careful, will miss the simple will of God in everyday life because we get focused on what my plans were, on what I think I can do, on what I've got scheduled out. I know I get up in the morning, I eat breakfast, I go to work, I do this, I do that, I get done, I got to drive over here, I got to put gas in my car, I plan this, I plan that. And we just put our days together and we don't factor in God's will for that day. We don't factor in what God might have me to do for that day. Lord, where should I go? Well, what should I do? Who should I talk to? How about this? When you're at work and when you're doing different jobs, or better yet, you're retired, okay? You're working out in your garden. You ever thought about asking God, Lord, when do I plant? Lord, when do I do this? Lord, when do I do that? Lord, when I work at my job, I know there's going to be some things I'm going to come up against. I need your direction so I can do the best job with great wisdom. I can do it with my mindset. I can do it with what I've learned, but Lord, I need your help. When we go to the doctor, we definitely want the doctor to be listening to God, right? We're going to go into surgery. Lord, guide the hand of the surgeon. Lord, let him pay attention to what you're telling. We want the surgeon to be very in tune with God. Well, he just went to work that day. What if he went to work counting on himself and not counting on God, and you're begging God to help him, and God says, I can't help him. He won't listen to me. You understand? It's just as important when it comes to our life as well. God wants to direct. God wants to help. God wants to guide. And yet, if we haven't put him in the equation because our heart is not on him, it's on what we can do for ourselves. It's very dangerous. Psalm 40 in verse number 8 says, I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I desire, my heart is to do the will of God. We also know, number two, it's a personal decision. Just like salvation is a personal decision, following God on a daily basis, following His will on a daily basis is a personal decision. And 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse number 5 says, "And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God." When Paul was talking about how they were trying to direct the church and how they were trying to encourage the church to be givers and doers, not just hearers, not just sitters, not just people who know, but the people that actually act upon what they know, and how to give regardless of the circumstance and the situation, be used of God regardless of the difficulties you may face. And they're trying to teach them these things. And they said, you know what? They didn't do exactly as we wanted. But what they did first is, nothing against Paul and nothing against those that were trying to teach the church, but they're trying to teach them to follow the Lord. But be honest with you, the people that they were trying to teach were so in tune with the right attitude and right heart and right desire when it came to following God, that they said in their own minds, well, we know what they're teaching us, but there's a step they haven't showed us yet. There's a step that we believe is more important. And so what they did is, Paul tells us that this they did not as we hoped. Wasn't quite in the process that we laid out for them, trying to teach them. They went a step beyond that. But first gave their own selves to the Lord. Well, why'd they do that? Because the folks there in Corinth, and as this letter is being written, the folks that the church is being written about, they here's what they did. They decided, you know what, if we're going to give, we might as well just go ahead and give us first. We'll just give ourselves first, and therefore everything we have belongs to God as well. So they gave it their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. Once they gave themselves, then they went above and beyond and they helped the missionary. They helped the evangelist. They helped the one going around trying to reach others with the gospel. And they gave beyond their power. They gave beyond their ability. But they did it because they first gave themselves. It's a personal decision. It's a life choice. To follow God is not something you can flip a light switch on and back off again. Flip it on, back on, and back off again. Okay, I'm ready to do it now. Okay, I'm going to turn it off for this week. I'm going to turn it back on for the next week. I'm going to turn back off. We don't do that. To serve God is a choice. It's a life choice. It's consistency or it's nothing. Chapter 2, verse 17, it says this, "And the world passeth away and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." Going on to Acts 13:36, "For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers, and so corruption." And saw corruption. But here, listen, that's in Acts talking about David, how he chose his life was serving his generation by the will of God. It was a life choice. 1 Corinthians 1:1, Paul, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ through the will of God. And Sosthenes, our brother, that was a salutation. That was how he addressed the church at that time there in Corinth. And listen, Paul said, listen, I was called to serve God. I was called to preach the gospel by the will of God. Now listen, it became something for Paul that was a complete 100% life choice, even to the point of death. He was stoned. He was beaten. He was thrown in prison. He was shipwrecked. All these things happened to Paul, but how did he keep going? How did he keep following God's will? How did he keep pushing forward? Because doing the will of God was a call in his life that he made a personal life choice. This is what I'm going to do the rest of my life. I'm just going to follow God. I'm just going to do his will. There are many times that Paul wanted to go one place. The Holy Spirit wouldn't let him. Then Paul wanted to go elsewhere, and the Holy Spirit would allow him to go. There were times that Paul wanted to go to Rome, and the Holy Spirit wouldn't let him go to Rome yet because it wasn't time for him to go to Rome. Then when it was time, God let him go. Paul was careful to follow God's will for his life, but he had made it a personal life choice. It was not just a, well, I'll do this for a season. It was, this is my life. Hey, church, you either follow God or you don't. He said, well, that's just too point blank. Well, sorry, there's nothing else I can do about it. You either choose to follow God and His will or you don't. There's one or two options. There's no middle ground. There's no gray area. The world wants a gray area in everything nowadays. Well, it's not right or wrong. It's just kind of, you know, in between. I'm sorry, when it comes to the Bible, it's either you follow what God has in your life each day. You seek His will. You seek His guidance. You seek the peace of God in the decisions you make. Or you don't. And if you don't seek God, then you have to follow and rely on yourself. And if you're not careful, and we all do it, I do it as well. And half the time when I rely on myself, I might get the job done, but I work three times as hard. Sometimes I don't even get the job done. Sometimes I just beat my head up against the wall, and I go to bed that night thinking I got nothing accomplished. Wake up the next morning and say, Lord, I really could use some help on this when 5 minutes is done. I really hate that. Trust me, ask my wife. I come to bed sometimes so mad. I can't do the entire day wasted. Can I be honest with you? That happens because I tried to do it. I tried to fix it. I tried to figure it out. And sometimes I get it. And I waste all day doing it. My wife says, well, why don't you just put it aside for a minute? I hate it. I can't stand it when she's right. She says, why don't you put it aside for a little while and then come back to it and just ask God to help you. Stop preaching. Okay. But typically when I do set it aside and I come back and I get my mind right, I get my heart right, I say, Lord, I really use some help on this. I can't waste any more time dealing with this. I need the answer. I have to figure these things out, how to put this together. Lord, I need to know what to say. I need to know what to put down, whatever. And as long as I get God involved, all of a sudden He starts taking care of things. We beat our heads up against more brick walls because we try to do it ourselves. When every single day God seeks for us to follow His will. And follow, listen, people have this idea, and I'm trying to hurry. People have this idea that following God's will means you have to be in the ministry. No! Well, that's what preachers do. Yeah? You know why? Because we're human like everybody else, and if we don't follow God's will, we're going to mess up. Following the will of God, doing God's will for your life is not a ministry thing. It's a child of God thing. It's what a child of God must do, and it doesn't have to do with preaching the word or sharing the gospel with somebody. It has to do with, Lord, where do I go? How about this one? Lord, where do I fill up with gas? That's one with gas going up. You ever just... I don't know if you've ever done this, but you ever had those times where you need to get gas and you just, Lord, I don't know where to get it. Everywhere around here is expensive. You ever had a particular place come to your mind and to your heart that's like, Lord, why would I want to go all the way out there? Why would I want to go there? I did it one time. I just had, Lord, just go over here. I went over there and it was like, I don't know, they hadn't bumped their prices up yet. Everybody else was expensive. They hadn't bumped their price, and all of a sudden they're like 15 cents cheaper. Oh! Okay. You just realize, I made the right turn. Why? Because God can guide even in the most, what we consider the most meaningless, simple things. He's not a God of just big decisions. He's not a God of just ministry things. He's not a God of just getting the gospel around the world. No, He's a God of everyday life decisions. And if we'll follow His will, we can have peace in the midst of decisions that must be made. I'm just going to throw these last ones to you real quick. I'm not even going to read all the verses. I'm just going to give you these last points. Because I pretty much hit them in a roundabout way. It should be the basis of your actions. The will of God should be the basis of my actions. If you want to write a verse down, you can go to Romans chapter 1, verse 8 through 12. I will read this one. Making request if by any means now at length I might have a prosperous journey by the will of God to come unto you. There's Paul talking about doing the will of God. Sometimes the Lord said, no, not yet. And Paul had to set aside. It also, you have to understand, doing the will of God may bring about some suffering. 1 Peter 3:17 says, "For it is better if the will of God be so that you suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing." That means sometimes we might get the short end of the stick because we choose to go God's way and not man's way. I'd just rather be in God's path than man's path any day of the week. You could also go to 1 Peter 4:19. I'm not going to read it, but 1 Peter 4:19 is another verse dealing with the will of God. And lastly, it does come with a promise, and I will read this and we'll be done. It comes with a promise, Hebrews 10:36-39. "For ye have need of patience." I really hate that. Because patience is not, people say, it's a virtue. Yeah, it's one I don't have much of. "But I have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul." Now listen. We have a hope that is steadfast and sure. We have a God that does not fail. We have a source that knows all need and knows exactly the right way in every decision. We have a God who doesn't make mistakes, who doesn't, sorry about that one. He doesn't do that. We have a God that knows exactly what must be done, when it must be done, how it must be done, where it must be done. We have a God that's in control of every single turn, every single twist in the road in our lives. We have a God that knows every single step that we're going to take in every area and direction that step is going to lead us in. We have a God that knows exactly what we need before we need it. We have a God that has the answer before we even ask for an answer. We have a God that knows more about us than any doctor could ever figure out by studying us for 1,000 years. And yet we don't use him. We go to ourselves. We don't go to him. We trust in ourselves before we trust him. Somebody once said they were in great need and said, "Well, I guess we're just going to have to pray about this one." Has it come to that? That's kind of how we do God sometimes. We try to figure it out. We do this, we try that. Hey, we can do this, we can do this. We got this. Hey, we got this new thing here, we got this new thing there. We can try this over here. We got a new area over this direction. Here's an old way we used to try this. It's worked on about 5 or 6 people. We go all these different routes, and then when nothing happens, like, okay, I just need God's people to start praying now because I don't know what else to do. Whatever happened to on the first issue, the first inclination of, you know, what's going to happen or what are we looking at? I don't even know what they're going to tell me. How about going to God then? How about saying, "Lord, I don't know where to go today. Lord, should I go the same route to work today as I went yesterday, or should I take a new route?" Oh, preacher, that's pathetic. Just go the same route. Yeah, what if there was an accident on that route? Or better yet, what if there's a future accident going to happen and you're going to be part of it, and God says, "I want you to go the other way." But Lord, that's 10 minutes further. Leave 10 minutes earlier and just go. What if God could actually direct every single step we make? You see, it's not his lack of ability, it's our lack of asking that gets in the way. What's our mindset? What's our focus? Do we really want the will of God for our lives? If we do, we'll seek him on a regular, not just daily, but moment by moment basis. We'll consider him first and then follow the peace of God he gives upon the request that we lay out. Everything in life can be brought before the Lord, and he does desire that, and he can direct with clear and precise peace with every step we take. But it comes down to our mindset. Is he first and foremost, Or do we go to ourselves first and foremost, and he's on the back burner until we need him? Let's put him first. Be surprised how much more can be accomplished and how much less stress we would exhibit or experience if we just let God handle it. He's got big shoulders. I'd rather just follow his will than have to suffer through mine. Heavenly Father, I thank you again for this morning. I thank you for your word. Thank you for the challenge. I pray that you'd help us to understand how important it is to follow the will of God in our lives. Lord, there's somebody here this morning that doesn't know you as their personal Savior. They maybe have struggled with it. They know the truth. They know, Lord, exactly what is supposed to be done to receive Christ as Savior, but they can't pinpoint that time frame. Lord, they really meant business, and it wasn't just words, but it was a true desire to repent from sin and to give their life to you and asking for forgiveness of sins. And I pray, Lord, that you would help them to see that if there's anybody in here that's in that situation. If there is, that they would come to a knowledge of knowing Christ as their personal Savior before they walk out the doors. For the child of God in here this morning, I pray that you'd help each one of us, Lord. It's so easy to follow the flesh, so easy to go our way and not seek your way. I pray that you'd help us to have the right mindset, the right heart and desires, that we can follow you with everything we do. Thank you again for this morning. Head bowed and eyes closed. Is there anybody here that say, "Preacher, I do not know 100% for sure if I died right now that I would go to heaven. I am not sure. I've struggled with it. Preacher, I just know 100% that I don't know the Lord as my Savior. I just, not really a struggle, it's just a confidence. I know that I'm not saved. I don't know what your situation is, but would there be somebody in here this morning and say, "Preacher, that's me. I need to talk to somebody." And I'll raise my hand and say, and I'll be honest, that's me. I need to talk about my salvation. Will you point me to somebody who can meet with me and show me from the Bible how I can know 100% for sure I'm on my way to heaven? Anybody in here, raise your hand and say, "Preacher, that's me." All right. Church family, how do you follow God? How consistently? Is he second to what we figure out first? Or is he preeminent and the first source we go to and trust for our lives? Doing the will of God from the heart. Maybe this morning you just need to spend some time with the Lord. We're going to give you an opportunity to do that. Let's all stand. Invitation's open. If you need to meet with the Lord, there's an altar down here. Or if you can't make it to an altar physically, then of course you have your pew. Come to the altar if you need to. Why don't you come talk to the Lord, spend some time with him this morning. These next few moments, the invitation's open. You do what the Lord leads on your heart to do. His name is wonderful. He's provider, sustainer, all-sufficient, all-knowing. We serve a God that's as wonderful as that. Church, why can't we trust him? Why does it have to be based off of, after I've done all I can? Lord willing, we'll put him first. Let him be preeminent in our lives. Thank you again for being in God's house this morning. Look forward to having you back tonight. We'll be looking at Sarah tonight out of Hebrews chapter 11. And be looking at a faith that believes the impossible is possible. Be looking at what God did with Sarah. And so if you look forward to being back. Try to be back in your place tonight. And keep praying for our church. Pray that a lot of folks we have need. I would ask you, I know for the Wendell Holmes, definitely. Pray for the Holmes. But also Brother Bob Owens has been sick lately, and it is really getting the better of him. He had a rough night last night, so I ask you as a church to pray for Brother Bob Owens and a lot of others. Many others, and not would not have mentioned names other than the Lord just laid them on my heart real quick. So be sure to pray for Brother Wendell Holmes, Brother Bob Owens especially this morning. All right, look forward to seeing you back tonight. Thank you again for being here. Let's pray, and we'll be dismissed. Brother James, would you dismiss us in prayer?